describe practices of intervention, but really what is they resort to traditional models of neutrality and professional independence. And I think STS emerged from a rejection of that traditional model of expertise. So that's, in a way, our starting point. And Luke sends his apologies that because of the benefit inquiry, he's just too busy to get away, but he has offered kindly to come back and speak to us in some future time. And I think that would be very interesting indeed to hear somebody, one of our allies, at the heart of one of the sharpest technoscientific controversies of the current period. But then that resonated with me because in the area of digital health work we've been doing, we've had a couple of successes in getting key contracts from NHS England. One is a contract to evaluate their flagship digital exemplar hospital programme. We had in the UK this thing we spent £17 billion on hospital informatisation, and it failed disastrously. The connected health programme failed, and NHS England is now trying to do it again, and they're trying to do it again differently. And the key element of doing it differently is to try to create a learning economy within the NHS about how to do digitisation properly. So we've been sucked into doing that, and we're also training NHS chief information officers. We're trying to create a new cadre. And Aziz Sheikh, who's the director of the Asher Institute, which is a health data research institute in the College of Medicine, says we've got 3 years to turn the NHS around. So we think, you know, we're not setting our targets behind them. But that's, so we're in this context of extraordinary power, and it's quite unbalancing. We've got £1.6 million to evaluate the flagship digitisation programme. Next week we're going to interview the research staff we're appointing. But 2 weeks ago, we gave our first progress report and our first set of findings. And they were impatient to have the findings even before that. But our first 3 month report, we had to give some findings then. So on the one hand, there's an extraordinary, in this case, extraordinarily receptive audience. But there's an agenda where clearly critical independent total science research has some extraordinary value. So at the moment in the UK, although we spent £17 billion, there isn't a UK supply sector for hospital informatisation systems. We depend on rather cheap second-rate American software packages. And one issue we might want to say is, should we be buying American packages, or should we propose small and medium-sized enterprises or creation of UK national champions? That's on the agenda. So we could be putting this on the agenda, but I find it terrifying. Because I feel very confident in saying that the American packages we're installing are not well suited for the National Health Service environment. They're driven by different health contexts and practices. But it's a very different thing to say that than to say, well, we should bite the bullet and try to produce our own or adopt European solutions. So one of the things I feel anxious about our own knowledge and its performativity and its efficacy. So I'm happy to say we have useful knowledge to help people think in a more complex way about how to address a problem, but I'm less happy to say, and we should be buying product X, or we should be using open source solutions rather than commercial solutions. permission to test that knowledge, but that terrifying. But we also need we will need to devise strategies for guiding our intervention. We also need to devise strategies for getting what we want out of the situation. We can easily see how we would end up being pushed towards short-term messages. You say being a consultant. So how do we actually make sure that our researchers are able to do properly valid and interesting and academically publishable findings and do that at the same time as we do this policy optimism? Bizarrely, one of the debates we're having at the moment is that our partners in UCL say this is not research, this is service, and we're having to fight with them about whether there's a charge of that on the other limits of both. So there's a struggle about, there's even a kind of a legal struggle about the status of this project. And I suppose I think these are brilliant questions. I think these are fantastic questions. I fear we don't yet have answers to those things, but it's a really good thing that we discuss them, because I think STS, we don't even have a language yet where we can discuss the kinds of accommodation we need. I've talked in other sessions about the need for a multi-level game, where we say, well, there are things we do to keep the sponsor happy and a certain temporality about that, 3 months of COVID reports. And then there's another cycle, which is the academic staff have to do serious, we're going to have longitudinal ethnographies, researchers embedded in the hospital to be studying what's going on, and they will have an opportunity to do the kind of conventional STS-inspired workplace studies and technology implementation that we think are really interesting. So we'll play a multi-level game where we're simultaneously producing short-term knowledge outcomes and also at the same time making sure that we have properly evidence longer-term studies. So we have a view of that, but I suspect there are going to be really fierce and difficult tensions that we will have to manage, and maybe I'd like to come back in years' time when we know how plans out.
Right, so are there any immediate kind of responses to Robin or questions of clarification? If not, we'll move on to Mark.
Okay, let's start writing. So I've got quite a lot. I could have said same reaction to Robin's talk, so we might come back to that, but I'll do what I was planning to do, which is kind of give you my version of this agenda. So I this is quite personal. And I think this agenda is quite a personal agenda for those of us working in the kind of broadly Swiss academic community. So I'm what's often described as an interdisciplinary energy researcher with an STS Swiss background. Okay, so I originally studied physics in first degree, decided that wasn't for me and went very much into interdisciplinary master's program at Imperial College on Environmental Technology. So I wanted to apply physics in an environmental setting. Then found that I basically needed to get a job. So I worked in industry for a while. And then I decided that wasn't for me either. And I came to Edinburgh to start my PhD in what is now STIS, but was then the Research Centre's Social Sciences Doctoral Programme, Science and Engineering, Policy and Technology. So, one of the things that we talked about, or particularly Jane and Robin talked about, was how we engage with power. So, for me, I found that quite difficult because I've always been interested in technology and power. I was kind of running through my whole kind of set of interests, my postgrad career, and so on. And I think if you're looking at energy, which is what I did for my PhD, it's quite hard to think about studying kind of an STS of energy systems and technology without thinking about power and politics. You know, nuclear power is the obvious one, but there's lots of others. So I've had a very interdisciplinary career, and at different times I've had more or less a firm disciplinary kind of anchoring in STIS. So for much of my career after the PhD, I've worked in non-STIS departments. I've worked in mostly Edinburgh. I've worked in the business school, geosciences, whole kind of generation of social science energy scholars from the 1970s, from the energy crises of the early 70s. But they were kind of hanging on desperately, small research groups, one at Sussex, of course, the Sussex Energy Group managed to keep going. But there was almost nowhere else. So I was probably for quite a few years until Stuart came up, back. Well, maybe the only energy scholar in, within the sort of SES kind of grouping. Did my PhD largely kind of independently, ultimately, because there wasn't that expertise here at Edinburgh. That's all changed tremendously. So a lot of what Robin said is very resonant with the energy world, in that there's sort of endless bountiful opportunities for funding. But the nature of that funding is changing quite a lot right now, in terms of the industrial strategy agendas, clean growth agendas, and so on. And that makes it quite difficult to know how to engage. So one of the important kind of branching points of my career was getting involved with the UK Energy Research Centre, which was set up in 2004. And I remember when I first heard about it, I thought, this is fantastic. This is what I've been waiting for in my career. That this is going to bring together social science, engineers, environmental scientists, policy researchers, and so on. It was funded by three research councils, given a five-year pot of money to go off and do work on how does the UK energy system respond to climate change. So I got involved in that over 10 years ago. Ended up coordinating the whole thing for 5 years, working with a research director in London. So Jim Ski, who's now a member of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, he and I kind of ran the whole program, essentially working with lots of senior researchers, but we devised lots of kind of projects and funded, issued calls for proposals. We had our own pot of money. So that was a kind of low point for my, in terms of disciplinary identity. My kind of this SDS identity almost kind of disappeared at that time because I was busy thinking about how to build whole systems interdisciplinary research program for 5 years. I realised after about 3 years of doing that, I know this isn't about interdisciplinary careers, but after about 3 years I had to kind of do something about that. So I made a conscious choice to re-engage theoretically with STIS, also to turn that interdisciplinary experience into active research area. So I'm now kind of publishing around interdisciplinarity and energy studies. So I think that's why I think these are very individual kind of orientations to, you know, if you have a very strong STS identity, STIS identity, and you've been able to maintain that throughout your career, you probably have a different take on engaging with power and what our agenda is, what the STIS agenda is, than somebody like me who's had periods of more or less kind of strong engagement as a STIS disciplinary identity scholar. So I came back into STIS 4 years ago because I got a Chancellor's Fellowship. And since then I've been kind of doing two things, which is engaging as a STIS scholar within these kinds of environments, but maintaining all the kind of interdisciplinary stuff I do with the UK Energy Research Centre. I also work now increasingly with an organisation called Climate Exchange, which is fully funded by the Scottish Government, and it's one of three national centres of expertise on kind of difficult policy areas, public policy areas. So Climate Exchange is actually the secretariat based just in Surgeon Square, and they represent carbon innovation. And so yesterday I was at a meeting with the Scottish Government about future funding kind of portfolio, or the future research portfolio of Climate Exchange. And it's very clear there that you're sitting very close to power, i.e. formal government, I've been giving evidence a lot to Scottish Parliament on the development of the energy strategy and the climate change plan in Scotland. So you have this kind of terrific access and terrific kind of ability to influence, but the agendas are often not set on the terms that you would prefer. So I think if I look at my colleagues working in this area, just at Edinburgh, there's very different kind of individual responses to this. So I have some of my colleagues choosing to disengage. They don't feel as though this is intellectually fulfilling. They think it doesn't produce high quality and publishable outputs. Other people weigh much more value to engagement, a kind of activist approach to policy formation on this hugely important area, which is, you know, very consequential for publics in Scotland about how they're going to, how transport is going to be organised in Scotland over the next 30 years, how we will heat our homes, really, really important issues. People are prepared to kind of suspend that kind of level of independent, sceptical inquiry, set in your own terms, for the sake of co-production and engagement, where there's a clear opportunity. So I do think these are individual matters. Do I have another minute or so? Okay. So I think we're in a really challenging place at the moment. I feel as though the kind of interdisciplinary, independent energy research, which has been really well supported at the UK level over the last 10 years, is now kind of under threat. My view is that we're being kind of subsumed into all kinds of industrial strategy, clean growth, local economic development agendas, which are not about the kind of primary kind of concerns that I've been working within the UK Energy Research Centre. So I think energy is a particular, energy and climate is a very particular story, because we've had the Scottish Climate Change Act, the UK Climate Change Act, which essentially imply a radical transformation of society over time. And these are statutory commitments. You know, it's so different from other sectors, I find it difficult sometimes to know how to kind of compare, but the fact that we've had this, and the Committee on Climate Change has been a kind of stalwart for maintaining this rather radical agenda about how society is going to change, is quite remarkable, really. So that has given, I think, license to people like the UK Energy Research Centre to be really rather influential on policy in a way that is quite unlikely, given it's a rather weak compared to business interests and other vested interests. So I do wonder sometimes, we're going to look back on this period, the last 10 years that I've been working in this area, as a rather kind of golden age of invitation to be independent, critical, kind of influence at the same time, and I see the prospects for that diminishing. One final thing is, experts disagree, that's part of this agenda, and what do we do in a context where experts disagree? So I'm doing some work at the moment on this with the UK Energy Research Centre and a colleague from Mike Tursey, who some of you will know. So we're just reporting these divergences, and we're trying to understand kind of reasons, rationales, recourses to evidence about why there is huge differences in the expert community, not on the climate change agenda, but how we decarbonise our society while doing lots of other things that policymakers are interested in, like more equitable provision and elimination of fuel poverty, clean growth and so on, localisation. And I think that's an important role, and not many people are doing that. I think this is particularly well placed to understand that, so we've got a strong interest in expertise and experts and how one maintains that. But I think ultimately I do feel we have individual choices to make here, and I don't think there are easy choices. And I think an active strategy of disengagement is legitimate in circumstances where, again, powerful interests are shaping research agendas in very kind of clear ways. One might decide actually not to engage, and that's, you know, I think that's legitimate and should be on the table for us.
Great, that was fascinating. And so I'm not going to allow anyone to ask any questions. I'm going to move straight on to Rob, because I think it would be good if we hear all three, and then, yeah, can bounce a bit more.
Yeah. social and political world. And so we have that kind of theory work already. So we are in a particular place, I think, that enables that. And I guess, again, this is not a new thing. So Brian Wynne has a very, I think, I guess, well trodden anecdote of trying to be hired by a nuclear company that he was part of during his shoot studies, right? I think there's another question about this kind of conversation is not a new conversation in STS. So there have been special issues specifically on intervention for 10 years now. I can think of at least two, three maybe. So what is it that is kind of driving this unease perhaps, or this kind of intrigue? Is it like a continued attention to reflexivity, or is there something kind of maybe more problematic or kind of, I don't know, pernicious? Do we think we have some kind of exceptionalism? Is there a kind of sometimes a belief that we have more agency we have, or the kind of change that we're imagining is more planned or rational? The examples that I have, I think we have clear examples where STS has made an impact in things. UCOVE would be one of those. The Demos papers is another one of those things. But in lots of the more micro scale things, actually, the people that we work with are not powerful in the sense of having room to maneuver. The kinds of shifts that actually make an impact are things that often come from unexpected places or in kind of serendipitous ways. And then what are the kind of institutional conditions that are driving this kind of work at the moment? I mean, certainly the impact of gender is one of those things. And I think it's worth trying to think about that in a little bit more detail. So you had mentioned this, Mark, so this agenda holds very clearly research and impact as distinct things. The work that I try and do is to actually begin to complicate those and begin to work in a way that blends those two. So, but there are again very difficult ways of kind of doing that, and there are conditions about the kinds of money use. Basically, one of the major things here is that consultancy fees are much lower than research things, and actually to maintain capacity over time, what we need is people. Which is harder to maintain with say, in that way. I think that's everything I have to say as well.
Great. Thanks very much. I think we'll just have a bit of reactions to people to what each other has said on the panel, if that's okay. I think for me, just a couple of things that really hit me. First of all, the question of we. So we have the word we in the some of these questions is like, who is the we? And I think that relates to our discussion yesterday about STS career paths and the things that Mark said about that not being necessarily straightforward. So the idea of having a we intervene assumes that there is a kind of, there's a body of we who's reasonably stable in STS. And Mark's point about choosing to disengage, I thought that was really interesting. Personally, I'm going through that phase at the moment and I'm deciding I might disengage. I keep trying to kill synthetic biology unsuccessfully. So that's enough for me. I think who would like to start with reactions to the others? I think Mark, you said you had some reactions to the problem.
Absolutely, I can tell you. tend to be very cautious about governments getting strongly enthusiastic about industrial strategy. Yeah, there's all kinds of mistakes where, you know, Tony Benn used to sit in the Ministry of Technology working out which design of nuclear power reactor the UK should plumb for, right? Now, that was never a problem for most of my career. And in some ways, people within innovation studies and stuff were saying, we need a much more engaged government around innovation agendas. And then we've got it. We've got, you know,
So, and there is no pathway to action, digital action, from that analytical work, or no obvious pathway to digital action, apart from things might be different in an anticipated social transformation, but nothing there. So I'm